Some Like It Shut. Movie Club Mysteries, Book 6. Written by Zara Keane. Read by Caroline Lennon. Chapter 1. Whisper Island, Ireland. Quibbles, I called for the 70 millionth time. Here, kitty kitty. I lay on my stomach and shone my flashlight under the mobile home. Discarded garbage? Check. Stray sock? Check. Rodent presents? Check times three. Recoiling, I scrabbled away from the caravan, putting distance between me and the three gleaming-eyed furballs. Unless Quibbles had metamorphosed into a rat, he wasn't here. I got to my feet and made an ineffectual attempt to brush wet sand off my bare legs. In hindsight, wearing a skirt hadn't been my smartest move. Then again, I hadn't anticipated spending my morning searching the muddy grounds of the Happy Campers caravan park after an alleged sighting of the rogue feline. I'd love to say I had better ways to spend my working hours, but Trudy Nelson, Quibbles' owner, was my only client. I pulled up the hood of my rain jacket and trudged across the muddy quagmire of the caravan park. So far, this summer had been a washout in every sense of the word. Business was terrible. Tourism was down, and the weather was lousy. Weeks of wind, rain, and gloomy skies had taken their toll on my finances and my mood. To be fair, it was only the start of July. Perhaps next week would bring sunshine and balmy temperatures. Right now, we were trapped in a groundhog day of April-style weather. As an escape from the dreary summer, Liam, my boyfriend, had promised to whisk me away for a romantic weekend in County Clare. Tomorrow morning couldn't come soon enough. A semi-naked toddler raced past me and leaped into a puddle, liberally splashing me with mud. While the toddler squealed with delight, Sammy Brennan, the carrot-topped 10-year-old who'd claimed to have seen Quibbles, snorted with laughter. "You're looking rough, Maggie," Sammy called from his caravan steps. I shoved my hands in my pockets, resisting the urge to flip him the bird. Like many of the park's inhabitants, Sammy and his dad were seasonal residents who ran a fast food truck by the waterfront. With clientele looking for medium-term rentals at rock-bottom prices, the park's money-grubbing owners didn't bother to maintain the property. Sammy's caravan was a prime example of this neglect. Courtesy of a busted tire, the vehicle listed to the left, and peeling green paint revealed the rust underneath. Happy campers indeed. When I reached Sammy's temporary home, I waved a soggy poster in front of the kid. "Are you sure you saw a Maine Coon?" He squinted at the photo and dragged a grubby hand across his nose before answering. "I don't know. This place is crawling with cats. Maybe it wasn't a cat at all. Could have been a ferret. Or a rat. Can I have my reward now?" I pocketed the poster. No cat, no cash. The boy's close-set eyes drew together in a scowl that made him appear cross-eyed. "You said the reward was 50 quid. If the tip helped me find Quibbles. Unless you can produce Mrs. Nelson's prize-winning cat, I'm out of here." Sammy was the walking, talking definition of what the Irish termed a born chancer. Without missing a beat, he pointed at a black cat slinking along the side of a neighboring caravan. "Will that one do?" "That's not a Maine Coon," I said dryly. "And she's pregnant. Quibbles is a tomcat." The boy shrugged. "His owner's fit to croak. She won't notice the difference." "Watch your tongue, lad," a voice boomed from within the caravan. "Mrs. Nelson's one of my regular customers." The door to the caravan swung open, and Mike Magnum Brennan emerged. Like his namesake in the iconic 80s TV series, Magnum sported shades, a bushy mustache, and an open-necked Hawaiian shirt. In contrast to the tall, dark, and handsome Tom Selleck, Irish Magnum was 5'5", with wiry red hair and a bulging belly that strained at the buttons of his ketchup-stained shirt. He also had an unrequited crush on me. "Hey there, Maggie." He beamed at me and quickly brushed toast crumbs off his mustache. "Is my boy giving you trouble?" "Not at all," I replied smoothly. "Sammy tried to help me find a client's missing cat." The kid shot me a death glance.
"Yes, I did. And now she won't pay up."
Unfortunately, Sammy's tip proved to be a dud. Magnum nodded as though this were par for the course and scratched a patch of exposed belly.
"Want to go for a pint after I close shop tonight? With the weather this bad, I'm only open the chip van for a few hours. I can hook up with you around 8.
Hooking up with Magnum was definitely not at the top of my wish list. "That's very kind of you, but as I've mentioned before, I have a boyfriend." And even if I didn't, Magnum wasn't the kind of dude to make my heart pound.
He shrugged. "Fair enough. A man can try."
"A man can also stop trying once a woman said no." My delivery was light but firm. I turned my focus back on the kid. "Thanks for the tip, Sammy. Sorry that it didn't pan out. I'll see you guys around."
"Need a lift, Maggie?" Magnum called after me. "The rain's coming down something terrible. I can run you into town in the Magnum Mobile."
I choked back a laugh. Instead of the swanky red Ferrari driven in the TV series, the Magnum Mobile was a first-generation Mazda MX-5 that looked as though it had survived a nuclear war. In addition to its unprepossessing appearance, the Magnum Mobile's roof leaked, a fact I discovered during my first and last ride in the vehicle. "Thanks, but no thanks," I said, straight-faced. "I'm already wet." Leaving Magnum mooning after me, and Sammy muttering about my unwillingness to cough up 50 euros for zero results, I strode out of the caravan park. In beautiful weather, Happy Campers was a 15-minute walk from Smuggler's Cove. Today, it was slower going. A dirt track led to the main road, and the rain had turned the track into an obstacle course. I navigated the puddles with care and kept my eyes peeled for quibbles. I had no real expectation that the flighty feline would put in an appearance, but I had to try. By the time I reached the road, the light drizzle had turned into a heavy shower, and the wind had blown back my hood. After I readjusted my hood, I shoved my hands in my pockets and quickened my pace. The wet walk into town gave me time to brood. While I was on the hunt for quibbles, Lenny, my assistant, was on the trail of a hacker who'd infiltrated a bus company's computer system. Apart from these two cases, business at Movie Reel Investigations was non-existent. Following our success in solving the Santa Killer case, we'd enjoyed a period of prosperity. Inquiries had flooded in, but with just two private investigators on staff, we'd had to turn down many of these job offers. Once the next news story caught the public's interest, the free publicity we'd received in the aftermath of the arrests had dried up. If we wanted to keep the lights on, we needed to score better-paying jobs than searching for an errant Maine Coon. Long before I reached the outskirts of town, my hood had conceded defeat to the wind, and my hair was soaked. I plowed onward, past the ferry terminal, and zigzagged my way through a gaggle of tourists huddled in front of the fast food trucks that lined the entrance to the pier. I inhaled the smell of fried carbs. My stomach rumbled. Skipping breakfast was never a smart move.
"Oi, private investigator lady, I want a word with you."
I halted at the abrupt summons and whipped around to see who'd called me. Peering through the rain, I spied a large woman waving at me from behind the counter of a food truck. Teresa Crawley, the proprietor of Battered and Clammed, a fish and chip joint of dubious reputation, thrust her greasy apron at her assistant
and clambered out of her truck. Teresa sported a permanent resting bitch face and a salon tan as deep-fried as her food. Neither of us knew that in less than 24 hours, Teresa would be dead, and I'd be accused of her murder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.